Great. So thanks a lot. I really haven't prepared too much in the way of slides, to be honest. And part of that is because, really, you know, I don't really necessarily know what questions you guys need answered and what things you'd like to know about this. So I want to keep things as interactive as possible. And I really want to emphasize that industry is a very diverse place, and that my experiences with industry are not necessarily representative of people's experiences as a whole. There, I've heard a whole bunch of different responses to the experience of transitioning from an academic position to an industrial position. By and large, almost all the responses I've heard are positive. But it is individual. Every single one of these positions is different. So I really do have to emphasize that this is my experience at a very particular location in a very particular research environment. But one of the things I can say is that my experience has been freaking awesome. So please ask, interrupt me at any time and ask questions. So before I start kind of talking about how I ended up here and what my expectations were and how, in many ways, they were defied, I'd like to give you a little bit of an idea of what Microsoft's effort in the quantum domain looks like. So first off, Microsoft Research is actually much bigger than I thought walking in. Globally, Microsoft employs about 1,000 researchers worldwide. And they cover just about everything you can think of in computer science, including quantum computing. The labs are located all over the place, including Redmond, which is where I work, New England, Cambridge, Beijing, New York, Bangalore, Cairo. I just learned that when I was researching this. Aachen, Israel, and Santa Barbara. Santa Barbara is the one probably many of you are familiar with. That's where Station Q is located. So the basic goal of Microsoft Research is twofold. Well, the first is to, of course, obviously, to engage in technology transfer between people who are working on cutting-edge research and transitioning that into product development. But that being said, Microsoft Research is a little bit unusual in that, to some extent, it also sees itself as a little bit of an academic organization, in that it really prides itself in doing work collaboratively with researchers in academia and trying to solve really hard technological and societal problems that we face in science, technology, and more globally. So Microsoft Research really also sees a lot of its work as being kind of community service, trying to push the envelope forward with these sorts of things. To give you an idea of kind of what this attitude is like, when I was interviewing for my position, one of the interviewers said when he was interviewing that one of the lines that he was told was that Microsoft Research's goal is just to do one thing. It's to invent, well, one thing. And for Bell Labs, that one thing was the transistor. For Xerox Palo Alto, that thing was the graphical user interface. For Microsoft Research, they don't know what that thing is yet, but they want to find it. So that's the goal, really to find something that is as transformative as those things and make it happen. So to that end, Microsoft, of course, has interest in a lot of these really kind of cutting-edge things, such as machine learning and quantum technologies, amongst many, many other things. So that was one of the things that I found kind of surprising. So what does it look like living there? Well, here's some low-res pictures I downloaded off of Bing. And this is where Microsoft Research in Redmond is housed. We actually are across the street from this, but basically that's where this is. So the inside of it actually doesn't look all that different from IQC. It's kind of an atrium type design, and the entire place is literally, this entire building is full of researchers. This is probably the biggest campus that Microsoft has, and it was, from what I understand, the first one that Microsoft Research was founded in. And so how many people do we have? Well, the group is actually pretty large. So these are just the researchers we have. We've also have an engineering team we've been developing. But we're broken up into two halves over here. We've got the QuArC group, which I'm a member of. And then we've got the Station Q effort. So the division of labor between the two is the QuArC group is really kind of the more computer science theory algorithms side of things. Basically, our mission statement, more or less, is to come up with new quantum algorithms, new ways of doing quantum error correction, new ways of compiling algorithms down into fundamental operations that could be run on a quantum computer, and basically handling the entire pipeline of going from a high-level algorithmic description all the way down, ideally, to a pulse sequence for a particular implementation to execute. So that's sort of the vision of the group. We really kind of want to do everything on the software end of things, and in including solving many of these practical, ugly, nitty-gritty issues that actually do need to be solved in order to make this vision a reality. So we have a grand total of 12 people in the group. Some of them you know, some of them hopefully you'll know soon. In particular, Matt Hastings. Many of you know Vadim. He's joined the group recently as a postdoc. Martin Rotteler, and Krista's the group leader, and John Yard, who's done some great work in quantum information, who's joined us as a postdoc. And Station Q, we have Roman and Mike Friedman, who's a Fields Medal winner, which are probably the main people that you'd know there. But one of the things that's most interesting isn't actually the people you know. It's the people you don't know. Because this is something that I found out perhaps the hard way when I was transitioning from academia to industry. Not all the people who are really good that you end up meeting at conferences are necessarily people you know of. Many of these people, for example, you know, will have diverse educational backgrounds and diverse backgrounds that have transitioned into the field from some other place. For example, you know, take Dave Wecker over here. He's an interesting case. His educational background is he has an MBA. He's doing very, very high-end quantum research right now. The point is that there are a lot of very clever people that exist in industry that are capable of training themselves up to many of these positions that you don't necessarily know are as good as they actually are. So one of the things that's very important, I found, at least, when I'm interacting with people in industry, is to recognize that there are some people out there who are awesome that just don't publish or haven't published much. So pay attention to that when you're interacting with people from industry. Many of them are really quite good. Another example is Burton Smith. Where is Burton? Burton. Ah, here, bad photo there. He is one of the co-founders of Cray Computers, who joined our group. He is a majorly important guy in the history of computing. And he's working in a group. I unfortunately did not know him before I interviewed. So the point is that one of the things that's a really neat feature of industry is that there's this kind of vast talent pool of people who are really clever, but outside of the academic system, that I found that people that industry can tap into and really kind of do some pretty amazing things that would be difficult to do with the talent pools that you have in academia. So those are some of the kind of interesting things. The question is now, I guess, you know, what is life like as a researcher at Microsoft Research? Well, one of the things I've found so far is it is, well, awesome. In terms of Microsoft Research, really the key thing that they seem to be most interested in is that you do high quality research. And in fact, they actively encourage us to go out and find collaborations with people in academia, because that's part of the mission statement, to foster communications with people outside of Microsoft Research and try to push the state of the art forward. So to that end, honestly, I haven't really found, at a research level, my experience to be too much different than it was doing research here. You're surrounded by a bunch of very motivated people working on hard problems who are excited about what they're doing on a daily basis and given a lot of freedom in order to pursue it. So the experience at Microsoft Research that I can speak for has been very positive in that regard. Yeah? Ah, very good question. I should mention that. Station Q actually is kind of more of a condensed matter physics group. So the main goal of Station Q, and Station Q was Microsoft's original quantum effort. It was started by Mike Friedman. There, again, doesn't show up so well from my angle at least. And the idea behind it was really to kind of investigate topological quantum computing. And the reason why this is a really interesting thing, apart from Friedman's expertise in topology, is because of the fact that topological quantum computing has the possibility of doing hardware rather than software error correction. So you might be able to bypass, implementing things like the surface code. You could use topological protection in principle to be able to directly implement all the gates you need at a logical level. So that's kind of, if you're looking at the sort of flow, ideally, Station Q could be imagined as doing kind of cutting edge research trying to enable these topological qubits that ideally people on this side of the stream would be providing algorithms for and compilation algorithms for later down the road. That being said, we're not actually completely wed to the notion of topological qubits. If other qubits come along that show promise, that's fantastic. We also do a lot of research on error correcting codes. So, you know, we're happy with everything. Does that answer your question? Cool. So that's one of the things that's really kind of neat about Microsoft research. The other thing that I found really kind of surprising is also how much academic, well, in a sense academic, perhaps that's not the right word, but how much freedom many of the researchers within the Microsoft system have been given. For example, Yuri Gurevich here, he's a very, very, very good logician. He decided that he was interested in quantum computing. So he said that he wanted to switch and spend half of his time doing quantum computing. Done. So this is a really big guy who decides that, you know, he has another research interest, and Microsoft has been entirely supportive of this. So this was, again, something that to me was really exciting when I came here, that they were as supportive as they were for people to do research that they were passionate about. So that's basically sort of the lifestyle there. Another thing that's really kind of nice. Yeah. Yes, actually, unfortunately, we do. I can't really speak about the gender ratio so much outside. Let's face it, you know, the percentage of women in science is probably much lower than I'd like to see across the board. I can't really speak to what the levels are like. I do see women outside of this, but I do have to say one important thing is that Krista is my manager and head of this effort. So, you know, that hopefully that might compensate a little bit for it. But yes, I would like to see more women be involved in this effort. But anyways, going forward, one of the things that I found is, well, what is publishing life like at Microsoft Research? This is the one area where there are some differences between life at IQC and life in industry. One of the reasons is because, again, Microsoft has two kind of mission goals. The first goal is to, as I said, enable technological development with people outside the Microsoft system. And the second is, of course, to enable technology transfer within the company and shifting from research through to development. So from that perspective, Microsoft, of course, has a vested interest in patenting many of its developments, which is a big difference from life here, where patenting often is just some annoying step that you would have to negotiate with lawyers in order to go through in order to protect ideas. Whereas in industry, this is one of the main objectives. And what does patenting actually end up meaning for industry? Well, I haven't been there long enough in order to speak great volumes of it, but so far, it basically, as far as I understand, well, the strategy more or less is to develop a large enough patent portfolio in order to be able to protect their interests going forward against other companies that are doing the same. So as for other companies in this space, there's obviously several big players. Google lately has recently made some big announcements about, you know, acquiring basically the entirety of Martinez's group, which is a huge acquisition, as well as Austin Fowler. IBM, of course, has had a long history of developing in the quantum regime, and D-Wave, which laugh all you want, but one of the things about D-Wave is that they have the largest patent portfolio out of any of the players in the quantum business right now. And this is something that, as the technology goes forward, people may one day have to contend with, that D-Wave has a lot of patents, and coming up with enough intellectual property to do transfers between the two companies so that everybody can keep on working is an important goal for all of these players. So patenting, obviously, is an important part of the objectives, but it isn't necessarily the only objective of Microsoft Research. There's plenty of good work that we end up doing that we just completely put out. And second of all, because of the fact that the organization encourages publication, unlike some other organizations, everything at least that I know of that's gone down, that has been patented, has also been published after the pre-disclosure goes through. So that's a little bit different. Now, what I mean by different is that there's other companies out there that I haven't worked at, so I can't fully speak for the experience. But I do know that there's other industrial jobs out there that are much more protective and much more secretive with their ideas. For example, you know, Hughes Research Labs is a great place. It's got a lot of amazing researchers. But one of the things about it is that they, because of the fact that so much of their funding ends up coming from classified sources, they really are extremely reticent to publish anything. So as a result, you have a bunch of great people doing great work, but you don't end up hearing much at all of what comes out of it. With companies like Google, on the other hand, there's a little bit more openness, but on the other hand, there is more of a culture of secrecy with their interaction. And on top of that, publication is something that isn't as strongly rewarded by the company. They encourage publication in cases where it's a really major, major thing that everybody needs to hear about from their perspective. But if it's a minor result that somewhat moves the field forward, that's the sort of thing that that a company like Google often discourages. Microsoft, on the other hand, tends to encourage publication of any result that moves the needle forward. So IBM, on the other hand, is probably a little bit closer to Microsoft when it comes to many of these things. But there are some internal differences when it comes to funding. Yeah. I've never been given a project. I've never apart from people in the engineering team, I don't know of any kind of predefined projects that have been given to people upon entry. Basically, they hire people that they know are going to interact well with the people who are there and who are going to do neat things and let them do it. As for predefined projects, you know, I haven't seen as much of that as I thought there'd be. Any other questions? Yeah.
I'm really curious about funding. You just touched on it.
Okay. So funding, this is something that is awesome about Microsoft. And it's also awesome from what I hear about Google's effort. Because of the fact that for Microsoft, as far as I understand, all the funding is internal. So what this means is that we don't have to worry about grant applications ever. We don't have to worry about answering to anybody but Microsoft. And so far, Microsoft is very, very happy with the type of work that we've been doing. So from that perspective, it's great. We don't have to worry about that, and we have the funds to do most of the things that we'd like to do. At other companies, on the other hand, the funding situation isn't necessarily quite so straightforward. In many other cases, like, for example, NEC historically, towards the end of NEC's quantum effort, they were relying 100% on external funding. So this ended up creating a lot of issues because people were constantly scrambling in order to get enough money in order to basically cover their paychecks. So this led to a lot of insecurity, and this led to a lot of issues. That being said, you know, it still was an industrial position, and they still had some freedoms that were quite nice from what I understand. But they did have to worry about securing external funding, and this proved to be problematic when the IARPA QCS program got canceled. So it's really nice from our perspective to have all the funding coming from inside Microsoft. But that is one of the differences. You know, at Microsoft, the idea is they want to, with our group at least, they want to be support and foster the development, and don't want us to be distracted by spending the massive amount of time that it takes writing up a quality grant application. Well, I wouldn't necessarily say the other side is more experimental at the moment, but it is condensed matter, certainly. Yes, everything. This is true across Microsoft Research as a whole, from what I understand. Well, at the moment, what Microsoft's policy is to have collaborations with external research groups. So, for example, we've had collaborations with Martinez's group, with Yale, with other groups, in order to develop many of these technologies. So that tends to be the approach for the moment, to partner with experts in academia and help develop the work that Microsoft thinks is interesting. I'm sorry?
Do they have plans for opening new labs?
Not that I can comment on at the moment. So, that basically is the thing. Obviously, we're quite interested in the experimental side of things because one of the main goals is if you want to have a general purpose compiler that goes all the way up from abstract algorithmic description down to a pulse sequence. You really have to have some notion of the hardware that you're compiling for. So we need to be involved with experimental groups. And we do have some strong collaborations. For example, we've got a great collaboration going on with David Riley's group in Sydney. And that's really helped us kind of start to understand and try to engineer around many of the electrical engineering constraint issues that'll probably come in when you try to wire together hundreds or thousands of superconducting qubits. So those are the sorts of kind of issues that we want to solve. And at present, yeah, we're solving it with external collaborators. Anything else? Moment. All right, cool. So let me talk about how I ended up getting this position. So one of the things I can say is that I cannot stress enough is when you're at conferences, don't always just talk to the people that you already know. That for me, I ended up lucking out big time, which is why I ended up being here. Well, I'd like to believe it wasn't entirely luck, but basically what ended up happening is I went to QIP in Montreal, and as luck would have it, I ended up presenting my poster next to Krista. And we started talking, and I didn't even know Microsoft had a quantum research group at the time. But we started talking, and she was interested in some of the simulation stuff I was doing, and then invited me down for a talk. So I, again, came down to Microsoft Research to meet the group, and one of the things I was really surprised by is that the group was as solid as it was, and yet, at the time, I hadn't heard of it, and I hadn't heard of many of the people who were involved in it. I think that's improving with time. But again, one of the issues is when you've got a group that's coming from a diverse background, sometimes it's within industry, they don't necessarily have the contacts in order to quickly generate the name recognition. So it was really kind of neat for her to invite me down and actually see what life is like at Microsoft as a whole. And that was when I realized that, yeah, this actually is pretty awesome. And it really is kind of what I was looking for, because it gave me the freedom to do exactly the sort of research that I want to do without having to deal with many of the bureaucratic headaches that come along with grant applications and things like this. So for me, it was a very, very good fit that I kind of fell into, perhaps serendipitously. But yeah, it's all been very positive. Any questions? Yeah, go for it.
How competitive is the atmosphere in your experience in industry compared to academia? Maybe right. Both in a positive and
sure.
Negative sense.
Okay, so let me again preface this with one of my observations Again, I've only worked at one place in industry, and I've had some interactions with other people who've worked in other places. And one of the things I can say is it's really my opinion that seeing it as a simple dichotomy of industry and academia isn't exactly fair. Industry is at least as diverse as academia, if not more so. So the corporate culture and the research culture from one group to another can be radically different. In some groups, there really is a very, very strong like team ethos where you know the team is working towards one particular goal and you're strongly trying to figure out where you are in that team and how you contribute to the team's objectives. In other places, the environment is much more individualistic. And everybody's more or less doing kind of their own thing and seeking ways of perhaps bringing other people in or whatever in particular projects. So for the amount of competitiveness, I feel that at least here, there really hasn't been a terribly large amount of competitiveness because for us, it's not really like we're competing over particular resources. All of us at the moment benefit when other people in the team benefit. So there isn't any back talking. There isn't any negativity about other people's work, unless it's cases where it's like, well, you really should be doing this. But that's no different than here in that regard. So I would say I find that in terms of how competitive it is once you're inside, it really isn't much different than IQC. But what I can say that in other corporate outfits, it's probably really different. That's a very good question. One of the things is that there's several incentives that they end up creating along the way. The first is, just like any company, there's always raises that you end up getting and bonuses. And these are tied to your performance, which are measured according to very specific metrics. So some people's motivation is partially monetary. By improving your performance on these particular metrics that they use for evaluation, then you earn raises. So that's yes, there's annual evaluations. So that's one way in which good performance is rewarded. Truth of the matter is, I don't really see that monetary advantage, at least for our group, is all that strong of a motivating factor. The reason why is because everybody's just really excited about this technology, just like I'm sure most of you are. And we put in ungodly hours usually, just you know, working on it because it's awesome. So for me, I think at least, and most of the people I've worked with, that tends to be the primary motivating factor. One of the big things though, I've mentioned the positives about an industry position. And one way which touches on this, which is the negative, is that there is no such thing as tenure in industrial positions by and large, really. Actually, I don't think ever. Basically, they reserve the right to fire employees at any point. So if you are chronically underperforming, then the company always has the right to remove people. So there is that fear down the end of the line. Whether that is a good thing or not, I think is something that's debatable. But that is one of the big differences, is that there isn't the security blanket that you can fully trust in. Of that, like you can with a tenured position. In principle, no. Nobody, going all the way up to the CEO is completely secure. Now, so that's one of those things. There just is not a tenure system, and this is one of the reasons why you know it's something to consider, the academic versus industrial dichotomy. If they all were just complete freedom, had you know none of the drawbacks. Then obviously, you know, industry in these sorts of positions would be the way to go. But there is this fact that with industrial positions, there is not the same security. And that's why for some people, pursuing a traditional academic route is probably going to be a superior choice. So, you know, that is one of the drawbacks. Does anybody else have any questions? Yeah. Sure. Okay, so it's like IQC, but people come in earlier. So what I find day-to-day life is you know, you get up and you drive in. Most people show up between 9 and 10, somewhere around there. There isn't really a fixed time that they actually ask you to be in. Many people work from home, even. So the that's usually what happens. We sit around, we work, and then we you know, usually find some place to eat on campus. One of the things to explain about the Microsoft campus is that most people imagine that, you know, Microsoft has a building in Redmond. No. It is easily probably 10 times the area of the University of Waterloo campus, perhaps more. So it is big. It is really big. We've even got like a mini mall that we call the Commons that's accessible only to Microsoft employees, with shops and a food court and everything else like that. Microsoft maintains its own bus system in Bellevue, Redmond, and Seattle. All right, this is not small by any stretch of the imagination. So one of the things that we often do is, you know, there's different food courts and things like that around. So we'll often go there for lunch. We'll sit, talk about research ideas often, you know, and usual stuff. Then go back, and people tend to work usually until 5 or 6, sometimes 7 or 8 in extreme cases. But Microsoft is very good, but I found about kind of a work-life balance. There isn't really, you know, the threat of the boss, you know, looking and judging you based on the number of hours you're physically spending in there. So honestly, from that perspective, I hate to sound like a broken record, but I didn't notice that being terribly different than, you know, how it is at IQC, except, you know, you are changing the plaza and student life center with, you know, other places. But I suppose that perhaps might be pointing to a more general fact of human nature, that in the end, I guess, social covenants end up kind of hitting universality classes. But yeah, yes?
So what does the group manager's job, entail, since it seems like everyone is kind of self?
Yeah. So one of the things is that there's a reporting structure that ends up going up. So Krista is the person that I report to, and many of the people in the group report directly to Krista. Some of them report to Burton, but Krista then reports to people one step up. I think she reports to Mike Friedman, but I'm not positive about how the whole org chart goes. It's kind of a mystery to me. But the point is that there's this reporting system where they report to their managers, and they report to their managers up, and it goes all the way up to the head of Microsoft Research, Peter Lee, and he's one step away from Satya, the CEO. So that's basically how it ends up going. And we're all evaluated by our managers, and, well, in my case, all of us actually do research with Krista, too. So, you know, it's kind of, it isn't really that you should imagine her as strictly being a manager. She does a lot of really good research, too, on top of that. So it's a little, I imagine it's kind of like, it's like Ray, I guess, in that regard, you know, in that you've got somebody who's doing a lot of good, you know, important administrative things in order to keep the entire enterprise going, but at the same time directly being involved in research. So that's sort of been my experience. Yeah. Excellent question. Yeah, and this is one of the things that varies from outfit to outfit, what their policies are on these, on many of these things. And this honestly was one of my concerns coming into Microsoft to begin with, because, you know, I got a postdoctoral position at Microsoft, and being a postdoc on a temporary contract, the question is, well, would this be a position that would help me get the contacts that I would need to get a subsequent position down the line? And part of that is going to conferences. Well, one of the things that I've found is that, honestly, at least with our group, I'm really fortunate. Basically, the policy is I don't have a travel budget. What I do is I go to Krista and I say to her, hey, Krista, I'd like to go to X. And so far the answer has always been okay. You know, so I've actually found that I've gone to more conferences now than I did when I was at IQC because, you know, working out of a fixed travel budget, you know, there's only so many, especially international conferences, that you can fit into, you know, $10,000 or $12,000. But I haven't had that issue. So we've been very fortunate in that regard. Other places, they may not necessarily be as keen to support going to conferences because of the fact that they see it as, some of them see it as a distraction from their own research, and something that really just doesn't, if they're not presenting, it is because they can't present, it isn't really a good use of their researchers' time. But I don't feel that that's the experience that I've had at Microsoft. Any other questions? Yeah.
I'm not sure if this question actually has an answer, but do you feel like there's a difference between working and researching in order to, you know, move forward this company rather than researching in order to, like, your goal is to move forward the field?
Sure.
Do you notice a difference between that?
Yeah. Well, it's one of these things where I think that basically my goal is I'd like to move both forward, to be honest. Really, what I'd like to do is I'd like to come up with, you know, much more practical algorithms that potentially could be run on small-scale hardware that might end up emerging within the next 10 to 20 years. So, and something like that, that might be able to have an impact on Microsoft's future development. Particularly some form of a compressed simulation algorithm for doing problems in quantum chemistry or something like that, may be able to lead to new understandings in development of fertilizers or understanding of photosynthesis. Something like that could be something that actually moves the needle for the company. And that, for me, is something that would be kind of cool. But I also obviously really am interested in moving science forward. I'm just really happy to see at the moment that Microsoft's goals and science's goals are correlated in this regard. But that is an interesting question because obviously, you know, when you're looking at a corporation, one of their major goals is to monetize. And it's really nice that, you know, in the cases of many of these guys, yeah, it's helping everyone. Yes. Yes.
So you wouldn't necessarily personally benefit unless it was through like a bonus.
Yeah. Yes. That's exactly correct. Now, unfortunately, I can't really claim that I've come up with a development right now that's totally revolutionized the field. So I can't really say what would happen under those hypothetical circumstances. But yes, if you work for a company, then one of the things that you end up, you do end up trading ultimately the rights to many of your discoveries, and that also can be viewed as a very negative thing, depending on the circumstances. So that's something that is, it's a very good point. That is something definitely worth considering before jumping on the academic on the industrial thing. This is one of the reasons why often you see in the tech sector people, you know, leaving their lucrative tech jobs to do a startup. It's because of the fact that then they have control over their own IP, and they can manage it from there. But on the other hand, let's take a look at one of the things that Microsoft does supply in this regard. They do compensate you apart from bonuses for patents that they purchase off of you, which is nice. You know, some companies will give you the token minimal amount of money they can give, $1. Microsoft is nicer than that. But the point is that when it comes down to it, also they provide a lot of really valuable legal services for getting the patent forward. Because it's one thing to want to be able to patent a great idea that you might have. It's another thing to make sure that you got the proper legal representation in order to have a patent that's actually worth protecting. So one of the things that's really, really neat about that is we've got some great lawyers to interact with and really help push these patents forward in a timely and easy fashion. And it's great to work with people, lawyers who also understand a bit of quantum. Because shockingly, at least on one occasion, I even had our lawyer give me a decent research idea. You know, so it's there are some benefits in this regard for getting some of these things out. But of course, a big downside is you are relying on indirect compensation for your ideas. That's a great question. So yeah, there's been a number of factors that are important for me. These vary from person to person. For me, financial compensation wasn't exactly all that relevant of an issue. Really, I want my first and most important thing is I really wanted to be in a place that was intellectually stimulating. I wanted to be in a place where I could do great work, and I was surrounded by other people who wanted to do great work. And on top of that, the other thing that I wanted out of it is I really, honestly, one of the things that's kind of a little bit soul-crushing I found about the whole academic thing is that when you go through, say, a series of postdocs and begin, say, taking junior faculty positions, you don't necessarily get to pick where you're going to be. You don't necessarily even get to kind of get a group of friends for a long period of time and keep them with you. And that for me was something that kind of sucked. I was getting tired of kind of moving from place to place and, you know, meeting a whole bunch of new people, getting some good friends, and then saying bye inevitably in 2 years. So one of the things that attracted me to Microsoft is, well, the fact that if you start with a position as a postdoc, you don't necessarily have to stay as one. There's the potential for advancement. And this is true throughout industry as a whole. If you get an industrial postdoc, say at IBM, then it's not guaranteed necessarily that you have to move on at the end of the contract. For me, that was a major, major selling point to Microsoft. And also, I guess the other thing is that part of me really is, I really buy in to some of the, to the idea that if we want to move quantum technology forward to the large scale level, we're going to start needing to bring on people with very different backgrounds. And one of the things is that Microsoft and other industrial positions, like at Google or IBM or any of them, have access to a really different talent pool than what we'd be able to get elsewhere. As an example, one of the things that Microsoft has developed but that I think could only be done at Microsoft, or perhaps Google and IBM as well, is our circuit simulation package, Liquid. So Liquid was designed largely by Dave and Alan here. And what the idea behind it is to simulate a quantum computer. And we can simulate on a desktop about a 30-qubit quantum computer. This is highly efficient code. And furthermore, it's designed to be very modular. So you can add on to it, you can extend upon it, and you can do quite a few things within this code base. Getting PhD students to write this sort of code is impossible. We've got software developers who've been writing this sort of stuff for decades at an extremely high level. So you really wouldn't be able to get a bunch of untrained people to be able to produce this in 4 years, and then once they move on to their postdocs, probably look at other things. So this is one of the things that's really kind of a neat, is that projects like this can actually be done. And also, the other thing is, getting the people that you would need to do a lot of the nitty-gritty engineering work, like dealing with bandwidth constraints, with communicating in and out of a cryostat. This is the sort of stuff that Microsoft and other companies have access to, these sorts of electrical engineers. And academia, unfortunately, at present, has a hard time recruiting that kind of talent that's needed to push it, I think, to the next level. So that's one of the reasons why I'm really excited about industry's potential role in pushing forward many of these quantum technologies as they start showing more and more maturity. So those are sort of kind of the majority of the reasons for me doing it. But yeah, I don't know. But if you want actually the honest answer, it's because I thought it was cool and I was excited about it. Yeah, Zach.
So
It's a very good question. You know, to be honest, perhaps not as much as I'd like. But one of the things that I do is I've been regularly interacting with people from the machine learning group. Because one of the things that I've started getting interested in since I came to Microsoft is quantum machine learning. And one of the problems that I really think exists in the, you know, I hesitate to even call it a field of quantum machine learning right now, given its current state. But one of the things about it is that it's very difficult because the people who can design the quantum algorithms for these sorts of problems aren't the people who know anything about machine learning. But the people who know a lot about machine learning, obviously, yeah, can't design. So one of the nice things here is that by working with people in the machine learning group, I've been able to help them, you know, help design algorithms to address many of the issues that they actually end up seeing in practical machine learning problems. And, you know, they can occasionally throw cold water on me when I come up with a fantastic way of using Grover search that's completely circumvented by statistical sampling, you know? So this is one of the things that, at least I've had some exposure working outside. Now, there's other people who, for example, like I think John is has worked with people in the theory group. And, but yeah, that's something that I think, you know, I would like to see more of. It's, in principle, Microsoft wants us to. It's just, we haven't perhaps been as effective as I would have liked, and this is part of my personal failure, too. Yeah.
So you mentioned that someone has an MBA in the group.
Yeah.
Oh,
gosh. Most people have PhDs, obviously. Alan, I don't believe, does. He was going through a particle physics PhD when he decided that, after seeing what a postdoc was, that, nope, this isn't for him, and he went and ended up starting up his own software startup and then sort of transitioned into the Microsoft sphere of influence. So one of the things that was really kind of fun with Alan in particular is he actually got his first, he got his first physics paper out less than a month ago. So, you know, which was kind of fantastic given, you know, how he started out doing his PhD all those years ago. As for, I don't believe he's got one. Everybody else does. So basically, yeah, under most circumstances, most people within Microsoft Research do have PhDs, but there are some very, very special cases where people end up coming from different backgrounds where a PhD may not be required to perform at a high level for what they do. The other thing I should mention is that, it's a funny story. Dave over here, he was giving a talk actually at a conference in Aspen. And one of the things that, he was an invited speaker, and one of the things that was really funny about it was there was a drop-down menu when he was registering for it that said, what university did you get your PhD from? So this is again, one of the things that I think is a little bit different. Most of the people who are doing research, in my experience, at a high level in industry, do have their PhD, but there are some amazing people who don't, who've just learned it on the side. So. You had a question?
Wait, did I raise my hand?
I thought you did. Oh.
I was going to. I just can't remember if I did.
Okay.
So, I mean, you talked a lot about Microsoft and obviously Google buying out the quantum experimental groups. Experimental, so that's my interest.
Yeah.
Are any of the other companies at this sort of industrial level interested in the crypto side as well as just computing?
Interested in quantum crypto?
Yeah.
Like,
or other sort of spin-off.
Of course, we're interested. We're interested in this. I mean, the issue is, I think, right now at the moment, you know, the technology really doesn't really seem to be kind of the killer app for QKD that many of us would like, because just the key rates over long distances don't seem to be there. Maybe when quantum repeaters start becoming a thing, then this would be something to reassess. But most of the groups that I know of in industry that are interested in quantum computing aren't as directly interested in QKD. Although I think QKD is super awesome. And I think the sentiment is similar throughout the groups. It's just, you know, it's not the thing that we necessarily do.
So there's
Yeah. The big one. Which makes it seem like a really limited kind of opportunity if you wanted to go into
sure.
this region quantum thing.
Yeah. Sure. Well, I mean, there are. There are some other groups that are doing this that don't advertise as much. You know, like BBN, for example, does quantum research. Lockheed Martin does some quantum research. There are other outfits out there that are actually doing quantum research. At the end of the day, my suspicion is many of them are doing research indirectly for DARPA or things like that. Like, I guess many people here are as well, but the point is that yeah, you know, those are some of the ones that I've mentioned, but I haven't mentioned. But the reason why I haven't mentioned them more so is just because of the fact that I don't have as strong interactions with many of these people because they don't tend to go to conferences, they don't tend to talk, and they don't tend to publish at all. So I just really don't know about what those experiences are, and not being an American citizen, many of these opportunities are kind of unavailable to me.
Do you think that it's more or less competitive to try and get into research and industry versus trying to get maybe like an assistant professorship or a tenure track?
I think both are extremely hard. You know, the truth is that, you know, in both cases, there's one thing that you've got to have. Every applicant has got to have, you know, an extremely high level of skill going in. But then the next thing, which I think is true for both academic and industrial positions, is that you have to be the right awesome person for the job. It isn't enough to be an awesome person. So you have to be somebody who they think they can put inside their organization and their social system and will actually help them grow and interact well with other people. So I think from that perspective, you know, there are some people who will end up getting positions that are, you know, hard to get but could get turned down from ones that are easier. Because it's really the being good is what gets you to the door. Being right is what gets you the position. So I think it's a little bit hard for me to say which of them is harder than the other. One of the things I can say is that getting industrial postdocs tends to be harder than getting academic postdocs, just because there's a relative scarcity of it. So for example, you know, Microsoft system over here is basically Microsoft has a system where they allot heads. So the QuArC group has a certain number of heads, meaning a certain number of people that they can have in this. They can fit in any job title they want. So if you're taking a look at a postdoc position, that's a postdoc position that's granted at the expense of a permanent position. So that's one of the things to consider here, and that's why it's actually quite hard to end up getting a postdoc position. Whereas with academia, these two categories are a lot more separate. Did you have a question? Oh, sorry, I thought you put up your hand. Never mind. But one of the things I should say is that I would strongly, strongly, strongly recommend that people who are interested in seeing what it's like in corporate life, industrial research more accurately. I really strongly recommend taking a look for industrial internships, because there's a number of these positions that exist. Microsoft offers them, Google offers them, I believe IBM offers them, and many of them are a great opportunity to work with really good researchers and get an idea of what it actually is like on the other side. And so I really recommend that people take a look and pursue these options, because everybody I know who's walked away from these positions have had a really positive experience with it. So that I think is probably the best way, really, to actually see what it's like, is to, well, experience it firsthand. Great. Thank you very much.